Shop Amazon for last minute gifts. Great deals for everyone on your list. Gifts for mom and gifts for dad. Even for your sister and your brother Chad. Ah shoot, we didn't realize we were supposed to get a gift for our dog walker guy. We almost forgot about our dentist Dr. Kerr. We didn't expect to get a gift from her. Or our cousin, I forget his name. He got us something nice, better reciprocate. For last minute deals on gifts for people you forgot. Get fast and free shipping at Amazon.
Everyone deserves a chance in the driver's seat. For GM and Revolt, that means leading the way on the road to an all-electric future and envisioning a world with zero crashes, zero tailpipe emissions, and zero congestion. GM's committed to making EVs accessible for everybody. That means you too. So what are you waiting for? GM's got the keys. You grab the wheel. Learn more about an all-electric future and the 000 initiative at GM.com. GM, everybody in.
You are now tuned into the Carefree Black Girl podcast, where we're discussing everything carefree, black, and girl.
Hey, ladies.
What's good?
What's up, ladies? It's your co-producer, Quanna, the Carefree Black Girl podcast. I've come with the sad announcement. Our co-host, Aya Jones, is no longer with us, but you still get a discussion on everything carefree, black, and girl. On this episode, we're talking about self-esteem. Stay tuned for tips on how to improve yourself to help others.
You know, you could say things in general, like it starts at home, because it could be people with like two perfect parents, happy, and the child is just a mess, or yeah, just a rebel, you know. Yeah. So it's definitely an individual thing, but I think that people just definitely have to teach themselves to be strong. Like, everybody can't do it, and some people are like mentally battling things.
I disagree with that part. I feel like it's not that some people can do it, but they can. It's just they don't know how. And I feel we have to give them solutions on like how to work through that.
Right. And that's what she was saying. She was just, but I agree with her. Mm-hmm. It's sort of the parents, but it's sort of like, okay, your parents are supposed to be able to guide you through those situations. So if you're not exposed to those situations, how do they, you get what I'm saying? Because I know they probably go through it. And my mom went through a lot. She was able to tell me, my sister's like, you know, girls might not like you from so-and-so. Like, my mom lived in New York for, 6 years before she moved back to Savannah. Like, she was born in Savannah, but then her mom moved to New York. And then my grandma was on some Queen Pin, get money stuff. So my mom came back to New York in the summer, Savannah in the summer's dress. So girls didn't like her. So me and my sisters already, we had an idea before it happened. But what if you wasn't exposed to that? Like, what if your mom wasn't in the streets, or they grew like up sheltered and they didn't have confrontations in school? So how are they able to tell you what to do? I feel like that's what building self-esteem is, because you don't have to, like, I don't know, you gotta throw yourself out there. Like, what do you do if you don't have that?
Exactly. That's why I said it's about being strong-minded, and some people just aren't born with that, because everybody is different. Like, I taught myself, I feel like, a lot of my street smarts and just stuff about life, period. Like, I went through a lot of situations. Like, thank God nothing was detrimental, you know, to my life or whatever, but I always felt like I was a person that had to learn the hard way.
Right. And just, like, put yourself out there. Yeah,
it's a blessing, because I feel like when I have kids, thank God they won't have to go through everything I went through, because I could put them on. Like, my mom taught me stuff, but I just feel like I went through it. Life threw a lot more at me than I think it maybe through her, or differently, and just,
That's true.
Just like different ways. I mean, I can't compare my life now to my mom, but I know like certain experiences or certain situations I've been in, I can already tell you that I know my mom has never been in, especially when it comes to like music.
Exactly.
And being a businesswoman, like, that's a whole nother ball game. Like,
right.
We don't have the same life.
I think it's important people to know and understand themselves to a point that they can identify when they're going through things, so that they don't put them onto other people.
Right.
And
I mean, I also distance myself too. Like, when I'm going through something, like, I'll just that's also part of my ghosting. Like,
right. And I, right. So if you're going through something, take some time alone. Take some time to yourself, right. Because other people, you could be around somebody and they might not understand what you're going through, and you're being mean and angry to them. You might end up losing a friend or a good, or make a bad first impression based off of just how you was feeling that day. Right.
But thank God for the friends that we do have, right, that understand what we be going through, because you always need a girlfriend to talk they damn ear off.
You do. Tell
okay, them y'all. Every detail. Six-inch heels all check, the lipstick check, raincoat check. Don't worry, cause I got that. Welcome to my tour, don't have to pay, cause you got the hottest ticket for four seats reserved with you. Yeah, I only do it cause I love you. You've always been here for me, so I'll do anything for you. I'm gonna. So Red sent us, what is it called?
The Rosenburg Self Esteem Scale. So we're going to ask some questions.
Okay.
So, on a whole, and I am satisfied with myself. So, on the whole, I am satisfied with myself. You strongly agree, agree, disagree, strongly disagree.
Are we answered? Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Agree.
Right.
Yeah, agree. I agree. Okay, the next question. At times, I think I am no good at all. Strongly disagree.
I don't strongly disagree. I just disagree.
Because I have those moments where I'm like, damn, am I not good enough?
Right, but am I not doing enough? But, like,
I mean. Yeah, so, okay, it's a between. But, yeah. All right.
So, the next one is, I feel that I have a number of good qualities. I'm gonna agree.
I strongly agree.
The reason why I agree is because I feel like I haven't discovered all of my good qualities. Right. Yet. So it's like, I mean, I agree. But I feel like I have so much more.
Yeah, I agree.
To learn and to, yeah.
I am able to do things as well as most other people. Some things I'm gonna say.
As well as most other people. I'll say agree.
I'll agree, but, like, it depends, because I can't do none of this sex stuff, honey. If y'all would ask me to say agree.
Yeah, that's why I said agree, because it just depends.
It just depends.
I'm going to say, hold on, disagree. Because, honestly, I guess I know what I know, mm-hmm. and I, like, every day I try to get better and, like, you know, just learn more about the things that I already know. I don't really be trying to know other things.
And I was going to say that.
Like, so, it's like, there's a lot of things that I dead don't know, and I don't even care to know because I know what I'm good at, and I'm just going to, like, develop those.
Oh, yeah. So, maybe disagree. So. Yo, because even just, like, I be watching shows like Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, and it be, yo, those questions.
No, Be Shazam is that show. I be feeling like, yo, I'm a musical
the
genius.
Questions.
Oh, God. Yeah, that show is lit. Wait, the next question is, I mean, we don't have to answer all of them, but.
Let's find a good one.
A good one is, I feel that I feel that I'm a person of worth, at least on the equal plane with others.
No, I strongly agree.
Yeah, I agree. I think when it comes to self-esteem, understanding your worth is
key.
Oh, my God. Can we, ladies, anybody listening, it's good to have a whole face, but don't be sloppy.
Oh, my God.
And I just want to say, like, because a lot of that comes from just, you could do what you do, but a lot of times you don't have to have a messy name if you can't help it. Because it's a way to be a hoe and still keep your poise. Because if your pussy is good, they don't want to fuck again, so they ain't going to get you.
I think the key to, like, maintaining your whole phase and not letting it get sloppy is not telling everyone what you do and who you do. Like, that's, like, so key. Like, I don't care if someone knows, like, oh, she's out here, like, I don't care if someone assumes, but if you don't really know, like, what I'm doing, who I'm doing it with, like,
that's fine. I feel like as long as you not disrespecting yourself, keeping it hygienically clean, then why not?
Right.
And you just not playing yourself. As long as you're not playing yourself, you want to do you.
Well, I think people should do them, but the the question says something about self-worth. Speaking for myself in general, like, I don't get sad if I fuck somebody they never want to talk to me again. Like, I don't attach emotions to sex. And I could fuck 10 guys in 1 week, and I would walk in the room with my head up, and you would never know I fucked none of them. And if they said something, I'd probably deny it to the death. And
they would like, oh, yes. That's
just because
really
you
good.
Can yeah. do that. That doesn't mean that you should. Okay. And I had to grow up and understand my worth and what the queen that I was. Like, everybody don't need to taste. Everybody don't need to experience you. Everybody don't even need to be in your presence. I think you said that on one of the podcasts. Yes. Like,
what's up, everybody? It's your boy Tone, one half of the best black movie review podcast in the world. In the world, Craig. This episode of the Blackbusters podcast is brought to you by Amazon Prime. Prime is more than just free shipping. Prime brings you closer to the things you care about today. Through shopping, streaming, and savings. For example, did you know that you can listen to your favorite podcasts, like ours, through Amazon Music? Yep. You can also watch your favorite movies, like the ones we review on Blackbusters, on Amazon Prime Video. Yep. But it doesn't stop there. You can use Prime to get more out of your interests. From purchasing behind-the-scenes books about your favorite movies, to listening to soundtracks of your favorite films. Yep, yep, and yep. Whatever you're into, or just getting into, Prime can help you get closer to it. Visit amazon.com/Prime to sign up. From movies and music to passions and podcasts, it's on Prime.
I should never even looked your way. I should never smile at you. Like,
people don't even deserve to know you.
Your worth. Like, even though you can, that don't mean do that.
So
shit.
I'm so happy that we got into this, because this week I've been having this like talk with my friends about, should you date guys that start from the bottom, or because it's like supporting, or like, whatever. Like, you know how they say, like, oh, he got potential.
Yeah.
I personally, I'm over the guys that just got potential. Like, yeah. I feel like you don't have to be the top-notch boss. Meet me at my level. Like, why do I always have to, like, deal with a person that's starting from the bottom, all support them, be this, be their backbone?
Why do we have to,
like,
always do that?
First of all, guys do not, like, date girls that start from the bottom. They may fuck them, but they do not date them. They do not take them serious. Why do we have to do that?
Yo,
you know what I'm saying? So I feel like that goes back
and
to
if they
worth.
And unfortunately, because of the way, sorry, this is not generalizing every black man, but the way some people think is, a lot of times when guys do date a woman that they look as beneath them, she has to be like submissive throughout her whole relationship in order to like keep his praise. And we've seen it happen again and again. A lot of those women get left for white women who come from well-to-do families who didn't have to struggle when the guys get up there. So I don't think it's okay to hold somebody down, but
if you feel like
it's not for you,
know when to drop that nigga where he stands.
Yeah.
Like, I ain't never been the type.
If you
could
pick him up, and if you're not struggling, you're like, all right, I got this, but I see that he's like trying to get himself out of this situation or working to be better.
Right.
But there's guys that will just lay in bed all day and then tell you what they want to do. But they're laying in bed all day. Like, yeah, I want to do this. I want to do this. It's just like, and your ass is getting in. It's no dinner cooked. Like, you working hard.
Right. Wait, but I need to clear this up, because I just said I ain't never been the type to build. And then I got cut off, so I don't need people listening.
My bad.
Like, no, but I don't need people listening like, what? She ain't the type to build. You know, dudes always talking about they want to build. But no, I was just going to say, like, I've never been... I'm always looking for the dude who, like, got it all together, which kind of sucks
sometimes.
I used
to like projects, though.
It kind of sucks, but I can never have a work and project progress or whatever.
Nobody's going to ever have it all together.
I know, because I don't even have it all together, so
it sucks. I mean, like, the basics, at least, like, okay, let's look at the basics. Not having it all together, because everybody got to work out themselves. So you can't be like, so maybe... He got his job going straight. You know, his career, let's say he's a doctor or fresh out of med school, just about to start his little residency. He got that together, got his little apartment. But you know, sometimes he be broke every now and then, so he can't take you out right now. But he got his shit together. You know what I mean?
Yeah, morals are in line.
Unless in line. So that's like, in that case, yeah, let's give or take. But at the same time, I'm not, if you ain't got no apartment, or
right,
you ain't
like,
got,
but
like,
he's working, you get what I'm saying?
You
like, he's maintaining,
like, different levels of that.
He's maintaining just his basic needs as a person.
I don't know, when a nigga broke,
Well, not. Mm-mm.
But those it's levels to broke. Bro. It's no, levels.
No, I know. Like, I know. Once the bills is paid, yeah. No, I right. know. But it's I just levels. Feel like.
It's broke mentalities and then actual, like, just I paid everything off, so I don't have the extra. Like, I feel like. Broken, like, you know.
Yeah, it's like, is this the mentality? Like, I remember when this guy, I met him at the bar a couple years ago. And he was telling me how he had this startup and they made, like, all this money and blah, blah, blah. And so I, like, looked at his Instagram or whatever. And I'm like, you know, I'm just searching. So I'm looking at Instagram. I'm looking, like, at 2012. The brother was homeless. Like, just, like, looking. Like, and he was like, yeah, like, at that time, I was sleeping in front of churches. I was doing a lot. He was like, I was really, like, down. He was like, I was at my lowest. He was like, but I never for a second thought that that was going to be my life. Like, right. My mindset wasn't. He was like, every day I got up and I went to work, even though I didn't have a place to stay. He was like, I'll stay outside all day in Manhattan and just chill and sleep on the train when I could. And he was like, my mindset was never broken, like, even though I was, like, in a broken state. And he was like, that's what it is. Like, that's what separates the winners from the losers. Because, like, when you start to lose, you got to still think about winning. Right. And when you still win, you still got to think about you got to win more.
Exactly.
It's never a place of complacency, and it's never a place of, like, I can't. Like, probably right now, not right now, but not I can't or not no, you know? So that was really interesting to me because he was like, this was less than 3 years ago. Because I had to meet him in, like, 2015-ish, and he was like, yeah, this was less than 3 years ago. I was homeless. And he was like, but I just kept my, he's like, I was working at Starbucks. And he was like, and then I got another job. And he was like, then I met my homie, and he was talking about how, like, he wanted to create an app. And he was like, well, I was creating an app too. And he was like, well, my dad just died and I got some money I want to invest. And he was like, it was just crazy because it was just all about just going to work and keeping it going. And I came and found the right person, and now we're both, like, multimillionaires. And it was
that's
crazy.
Was that really is dope. I don't know, but don't ask me. I'm single anyway, so I guess dating advice, scratch everything I said.
Yeah, no. Same
No. You just never know. You got to date based on where you're comfortable at, and right. I feel like that has a lot to do with you and, like, what you want.
It has a lot. Like, sometimes, like, seriously, like, lately, I've really just been on some, like, I'm not dating someone that I have to feel bad for, like.
Nah, I like me a baller.
I like, no, and that's the thing. Like, I'm tired of, like, pretending not to like those kind of, you know how, like, because
I don't want a baller.
No, not a baller, but it's just.
They don't have to be a baller. That's the thing. It doesn't have to be.
I don't know.
Balling. However they doing it, I don't know.
You know how you was just saying that guy was just, like, homeless, but. He just kept going. Like
ambition. That, it's like it's ambition. The, like, I love the exactly ambition. Like, I don't care where you at. Ambition. Like, because you could be a wealthy motherfucker. And I know wealthy dudes with kids out here who don't talk to their baby mama, don't want to see their kid, don't want to even acknowledge that that's their seed. But girls flock to them because of their wealth. But what is going to happen to you when you are in the same boat? Like, you really got to, like, consider that. I know you choose the good guys, though, so I know this doesn't pertain to you, but it is a lot of girls. Like, if you're listening, I know y'all like to talk to the ballers and the, you know, the guys that have it together, but just make sure that he's treating you right.
And make sure you have your own.
And your own.
Like, that kind of is, like, super, because, I mean, it wouldn't matter what a guy's doing for you if you have your own. Like,
exactly.
I mean, I was, like, again, I don't need a guy for money. Like, I just prefer him to have money, you know? So, same for me. Like, I want to make sure I'm always good. And it's just always back to self-worth. How do you feel like, what do you feel like you deserve? What do you feel like, what would you treat you like? Right. And that's how you kind of have to date people. And sometimes we kind of, like, I know for me, like, dealing with my insecurities, I now look back and notice why I dated people for certain things. Because it was just like, you know, he was treating me how I was treating me. And then now it's like, I'm treating me good. And I notice how, like, single I've been, like, and who I've talked to. Just like, all right, yeah, now I'm in a better place. Because before I would just deal, whatever, this is us. But now I'm like, bro, like, I'm low-key Beyonce. So you're not going to do this to me. Yeah. Like, I'm good.
Dating much. I feel like even now in the people I date today, I'm learning more about the type of guys, like, I'm seeing just personalities and dudes that I don't want to be with, and necessarily, like, those were always the type of guys that I maybe went for. But now I'm getting older and just learning more about myself. I'd be like, dang, I actually don't want a guy like that. Or maybe I am noticing it's fun for now. But in the long run and like looking past the exterior and just a partner, like a life partner, taking it that far, just like if you want to talk about marriage, that's like super, a person is so complex. I feel like I'll be jumping into stuff quick, like, and like that's just true. Like I meet somebody and like them at first, you know, and just be so excited and rush into things, and then it's just so much more to learn about the person. So as you get more into it, it's like, nah, that's not really what I want. So I'm just like kind of falling back from the dating scene because it's a lot.
You know, dating could be different things. Going out with people, hanging out. It could be the sexual part. It could be the emotional part. Whatever you define dating as, that's what I'm learning. Because I did not know how to fucking date. I thought having sex meant dating, and that's not dating.
Oh my gosh.
No, going out. But even, okay, I went out last night with this guy. We went to the. He's an Albanian.
See, Dodge always got some exotics. I like black.
She like a foreign.
She Dodge like foreign.
So we went to Lavo, to the nightclub, and like I don't drink at all, so I just had a cranberry juice, anyways. And I don't know. I guess going out with my friends or like somebody who I'm really interested in, it could have been fun.
This episode is brought to you by Undeniably Dairy. Dairy farmers are more than farmers. They're climate caretakers. They see water as a precious resource. Most farmers recycle water up to 4 times, from chilling the milk to irrigating the crops. And some even use technology to turn manure into renewable energy. To learn more about what dairy farmers are doing to make their farms more sustainable, visit usdairy.com.
And if you're not drinking, but I was so just like, this is fun because like we in this nice club, you know, the guys buy you stuff. But I was like, I do not even want to be here. I'm not even interested. So dating could be, you know, some people just like go out, have your fun, get dinner, get whatever. But I'd be like, nah, I don't even want to be bothered right now.
I feel you. Yeah, you where are you, where you feel like you at? You feel like you're in a place of like self-discovery? Because I've been there before. And moments are just like, every year I'm going, if I'm not dating somebody, I'm going to take a couple of months without having sex. Because that felt good this year to like take a few months and just be like, you know what? I'm just going to focus on me and use my time wisely. When I want to fuck, I'm going to go to the studio or something. That felt good. That really did.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, I would like to meet somebody who I'm feeling. Like, I don't know. I guess I just don't be meeting people who, like...
So you're working on yourself right now. There's nothing wrong with that. Wait, do y'all want to finish the self-esteem test? Let me see.
Yes.
What's the question?
I don't see. Like, let me see.
I take a positive attitude toward myself. Strongly agree.
I take a strongly... Say that again.
I take a positive attitude towards myself.
I'll say agree.
Yeah, I agree.
Because sometimes I know I have a bad attitude and I need to check myself. I just feel like...
Okay, now I'm confused. Is it like a
bad... It says towards yourself.
Towards yourself. So it's just like, is that...
Like, how do you feel about yourself?
I think it's just about being in control of your emotions and just how you act then, right? Yeah. Kind of. Like, even if you have an attitude, like, check yourself. Like, you the one that got that attitude.
I was thinking more, like, circumstantial. There. Like, do you have a better, like, positive attitude and different?
I don't know. Because for the most part, I think highly of myself. I always think of myself in a positive light. But I think I come across... at times not so positive,
right? Or like doubt, like I know I like deal with certain still doubts, so it's like, and I think that be
that may come across at times in my dealings with people. I mean, I agree that I feel, that's what I'm saying, it's like it says towards yourself, like I feel good about myself, but I know like my actions at times might not reflect that. So I don't know. It says, all in all, I'm inclined to feel that I am a failure. I strongly disagree.
Yeah, I strongly disagree.
Strongly disagree. Girl, put on your seatbelt. It's gonna be a ride. Cause you are so amazing when you're naked.
last episode, we were talking about white supremacists and all that stuff. So, okay. I finally, like, saw it up close and personal. Like,
really?
Okay. That's what I meant to say on the podcast, too. So, me and Dodge, she dragged me to this Dave East listening session the other day, right? So, I'm on the train. That's when I left you. And I'm on the train. It's this, like, you know, on the D train, they have, like, the two seats together. Mm-hmm. And then, so I'm, like, by the window, and there's this black guy with a bike, like, right across. So, there's really no one on the train. No one's bothering about the bike. A couple stops later, I want to say maybe 34th, this white lady, like, her friend. Now, the white lady is, like, super drunk. So, like, she's trying to go to, like, the inside seat, like, by the window. So, she sits on the bike, sits on him, then sits in her seat. But she never said, like, excuse me. She just did it. And she was drunk, but she wasn't drunk where she couldn't control herself. Like, mm-hmm. she was walking by herself. So, the black guy kind of just went off on her, like, yeah, like, you know, matter of fact, he was, like, probably Caribbean because he had an accent. He was just like, you're so effing rude. Like, say excuse me, all this other stuff. Like it was so disrespectful. So he started really going in on her, like, wash a pee, you know. So she was like, what? Are you speaking Ebonics or English? So that's when my whole neck jerked. Like, I was trying to mind my business, y'all. I really was.
Really?
I was trying. But when she said, because he was speaking perfect English. Yeah, it had a little accent, but, like, you can hear exactly what he was saying. He was saying, like, you have no manners. You're rude. You're this. So for you to automatically be like, are you speaking English? Like,
right.
So.
Because when you call them out, it's like, now you the ignorant. They get ignorant with you when you call them out.
So. And they oh my God. So, no, like, my head just jerked. And I took my headphone out because I was going to say something. So her friend came and sat, like, in the seat in front of us. So the friend was like, excuse me. So the guy started clapping, like, yes, someone with manners. Like, and then she was just like, he told me something about my pussy. So then there was a lady behind me that was like, my son is behind you. Don't repeat the story. We all heard. So she was like, excuse me? Who's talking to you? It was like, I felt really? Bad because we really just had to go in on her.
Really?
Like,
y'all all went on
we
her.
All went
you
on
had
her.
To. And that's what I had to let them know. Like, who the fuck do you think you are?
She was just like, I was not in the wrong. So I was like, yes, you was in the wrong. Like, and then, like, the girl was like, listen, sir, do you want to switch seats with me? Because, like, she's going to get slapped. I can slap her. Like, and then, like, she just started going on this rant. And I really did gas. I was like, exactly. Like, keep that same energy.
Right. Yo, I hit her. Hit her.
I was just like, she don't even know she's about to get. And then, like, getting off the train, I had to laugh at myself because I wasn't trying to, like, egg the situation on, but I really was bothered. Like
you really
made
me bad.
Are you speaking Ebonics or English? Like, bitch, he's speaking perfect English. And to me, that was just a microaggression. Like, you know, like,
yeah,
I guess
like,
that
why do you
that. That was so rude. And I felt like a way. And I just don't know now, like, if I can really ignore it. Because ever since that one incident, like, every time I speak to someone that's not of color, like, I'm, like, I listen to exactly how they say things.
Right, and just try to understand. I mean, because that's the first thing that somebody, like a Caucasian white person would say. They would try to come for your dialect or just how you look. No, like, we're doing the same. We're speaking, breathing the same air. We're speaking the same language.
Exactly.
If I'm talking too fast, slow down. I'll slow down for you.
Yo, the most thing I hate is when white people mock you after you say something, like, and they try to say it back in a very, like, what you saying, like, you know, like, trying to put the flavor on it. Like, no, that irks my nerves.
I mean, but at the same time, I feel like if you do know them on a personal level, because some of these people we work with, I feel like that's a moment before we get, like, all right, I got mad because I didn't know them. But it's also a time where you could just teach them, like, or not teach them or say, because, like, one of my interns from my job, he was just like, oh, you always have some crazy hairstyle. And I was just like, excuse, like, I was just like, wait, what do you mean by crazy? He's like, because first he started off the, how long it took you to get your hair like this? And I'm like, it's in a bun. Like,
I just feel like you're going to hear that, though, all the time. So, and so why did you have to?
So I understood what he was trying to say. Oh, these
I mean,
different.
Like, you
he
mean,
said crazy. So
she
I just told him.
Get upset?
No, I was
no,
like,
not get upset, but
you should teach them. Like, with
them.
Him, yeah. I was just like, listen, I know what you're saying, but this is how you say it. So it does not come come off offensive. I'm like, you know, like, just in case you're speaking to someone else, say it like this.
Right.
I didn't automatically, like, oh, what you trying to come at me? Because sometimes, which is not making it right, they don't have that black person to tell them how to say something.
Yeah, you have to put every opportunity.
So, but with that girl on the train, I feel like no.
But then you just tell them white people every day how to talk to black people.
No,
no, everybody's not disrespectful.
All I'm saying is you picked that one part. Like I said, I understood where he was coming. He was not trying to be offensive. He just
all of them are disrespectful, but at the same time,
so the one you can tell when someone's trying to be offensive, someone's trying to understand. Like,
she clearly sat on him and did all that and thought he wasn't gonna say nothing. And then you went and talked about pussy and somebody's son on the train and you're talking about who's talking to you. No, bitch, I'm talking to you because my son's sitting right here.
The crazy thing is the mother just started.
I would be ooh guy.
But the mother just started cursing OD. And I was just like, oh, but you just told her not to curse her. And it's like she read my mind. She was like, and the reason why I can fucking curse is because this is my fucking son. I was just like, okay, because that
makes sense. It was lit on the train.
It was lit on the D train, and I'm like, why am I? It was so much.
Why did I have to be on the train today?
And like, yes, because she got off on 125th because, like, I guess they was like, what stop you getting off? Get off of Tremont or whatever. And like, somebody else in the on the train was like, you know, they not going past 125th. And soon as 25th came, she got off. But you could tell just we was kind of like together like on that train. I kind of like even though it was
that's what it needs
drama,
to be more camaraderie amongst so, people right. against like, these races.
We didn't know
they,
anyone like we didn't know each other, but we all backed each other up like and we told her like no, you were wrong because like, just imagine if we didn't say nothing and the whole time she's going off telling a story, no one's speaking up.
Right.
So I think that's also a major part. Speak up. And know when to just maybe teach. Like,
as yeah, and as I think really that's, ooh, you hit it in the nail in the head. Definitely let your voice be heard. If you feel like you're talking to somebody that's ignorant, let them know. Dick Gregory died today or yesterday.
Yesterday.
And he said something, it was a quote I saw earlier. He was like, every black man is not the same. And it was basically saying that, like, your type of black might not be my black. I was, you know, in Harlem the other day talking to this man at the store and he's talking to me in Spanish. He starts speaking Spanish. He's darker than me.
Okay.
And he's like, you know, he's Dominican. He was like, English is his second language. And he was like, he got so good at it because like everybody treated him like a black man and he wasn't used to it, but he had to like understand what that meant. And he still don't really understand like the class systems when it comes to black people and stuff like that. And it's really interesting. Like, how people are conditioned. Like, it all is in your upbringing. Like, the black people in New York, in Brooklyn, is not Southern black people like me. Like, I have five generations of my family who've, like, lived in America, who've, like, my grandfather's people were slaves. My grandmother, she will swear to death that her people weren't slaves. She was like, my family was the indigenous people who were here first. Like,
different type of
Indians, like they got Yamacraw, Cherokee. She's always like, these are my relatives. And my grandfather, he was a slave. So it's like, coming to New York, you got people who just came to America from other places.
Right.
And they might not know slavery the way an American would know slavery.
Right.
And so for me to assume that you don't know why everybody's mad about the monuments, like I can't assume that because you might have to educate somebody that look like you, just like you might have to educate somebody that don't look like you.
Wow, Quanna, you hit it. And that's just, it goes all back to just educate. At this time, I think what we really need to be doing is, one, willing to learn. And also, like, learning from my wife. Because, you know, Dick Gregory did die. And I feel like all his wisdom died with him.
Yes.
But he also did a good job as, like, talking and spreading
words.
Yeah,
filming himself.
We need to really, like, get close to our elders in this time. I think we need to really, like, listen to their stories, really, like, and just how they got through it as well, you know, just so we can also know how to move in our times and then learn how to at least just be willing to educate other people, like spread the knowledge. We're so busy also condemning each other for not knowing what, like you just said, like back to this, like, situation in Virginia. I don't know all the details and someone tried to come at me like, how you don't know you're black? And it's just, this is the time.
I mean,
when
like every detail is really, this is a thing. Trump inspired a certain amount of hate that's been, like, sleeping in this country for a while. So just being a Southern Black American, I'll say that there are people in the South, I think Ayaz mentioned this last time, whose whole well-being relied on slave labor, so they didn't want to work. Like, they was the lazy people who sent a slave to do, like, simple jobs. And when slavery ended, these people had to actually work because slaves, you know, some people started, had their own land, some mm-hmm. people, you know, whatever, but it was some black people who still needed to work for these people. Now, the people who couldn't afford to do that, to hire and create businesses, they're just like us. And they're in these dark trench towns and they're poor. And those are people who get all the food stamps, and we try to blame black people, but white people get more food stamps than us. They steal the most.
My friend gets like $16 in food stamps.
Yeah, they get way more than us. If you look at in New York right now, in Crown Heights gets the most Section 8, and it's like mansions over there. So basically, I said all that to say, people just, you know, I lost my train of thought. But
no, yeah, but it's just crazy, like these times. And also,
I remember what I was going to say. Okay. I said, I have to say, like, people really, they don't want to be on the same playing field as black people. Like, that's their whole thing. Like, they don't want to feel like a black man is on the same level as me. Even if I'm poor, a black man should be even poorer than me. And that's what all this racism came from. And all these statues just represent racist people. Like, the guy who was doing all these surgeries on... what's his name? Like, do y'all know his name? Like, he's like an ancient, like an old doctor, a gynecologist, and he felt like black women feel less pain so he could perform surgeries on them without anesthesia.
Oh, hell yeah. So, no. Like,
people want his monuments taken down.
Yes.
Yeah.
Immediately.
Yeah. I wasn't really prepared on that one, but I'll get his name and yes. come back. But, like, that's why everybody's upset. But to your point, like, it's so much history that goes with it. So, if you aren't aware, it is a lot to take in. Right. So that's why they want all the monuments taken down, and they was going to take one down in Virginia at the college. These white nationalist groups all formed together, like all these groups, all these KKK, all these white people who scared they're poor, all these people who hate LGBT, they all rallying together, and they want to have a march. And that's, it was a successful in Charlottesville. The police decided they didn't want to stay. They was beating up black people or anybody who walked past, and this shit was just fucked up. But we already discussed that.
Yeah. So we're not gonna give them no more shine. Don't want the statues being taken down.
No, they, because no. everybody else wanted it taken down because of what it represents. Because
he's a white doctor.
But it's well, it wasn't him. It was a slave master. What's the guy's name?
But he's a white guy.
Yeah.
Okay, so black people wanted it taken down.
They want all Confederate statues and flags taken down. Okay. That's just the general thing. I feel like that's
thing. So the white people was marching to not have the men statue taken down.
Yo, I can't even. It's just,
they was big mad.
Like I said, right now, like, I know I come across as, like, this prejudice, hate white people. It's how I was raised, but I'm trying to, like, really not understand them, but I'm trying to now, like, present day, like, this week, Ivy is just trying to, like, teach people, like, yeah. Because I'm tired of just walking around being mad at this, like.
And again, reminder for black people, just be comfortable in yourself.
Jay Marinson. Because
white people, it's so easy to feel uncomfortable around them, even in places, like, where it's predominantly white or whatever.
But
so,
it also goes back to self-esteem. Like, I feel exactly. like I don't feel uncomfortable.
So that's why, that's right. That's people. Why I'm saying.
I don't ever feel uncomfortable around them. And yeah. I hate when people try to tell me how to act in their presence. Like, they should be happy I even want to be around here, this motherfucker. Like, that's how I be feeling. like what? Like, the standard that they set is basically to diminish our culture. So I be trying to figure out, like,
that they can't.
Why do people want to do that?
Our culture is so rich, it's really indestructible.
Oh, the doctor that I was talking about earlier, they call him the father, and I'm doing air quotes, of modern gynecology, and it's James Marion Sims. And yeah, like I said earlier, he did surgery on black women without anesthesia, saying that they were stronger, and they got his statues all over everywhere, and people want to take them down. And yeah. Oh, God. He was from, they got him at Jefferson Medical Center.
Wow. That's crazy.
Yeah.
I can't even take needles. Like,
yeah, it's just like, what? Like, I couldn't even imagine living in those times.
Yeah.
And I think you said one time, Dodge, just to go bring it back to self-esteem, the reason why we have all these, like, I feel like a lot of people have issues is because of, like, the history and where everything came from and the fact that it's being taught over and over again. Mm-hmm. But it's like,
yep.
We get done taking all these statues, y'all. And I feel it. I get it. I get why y'all want to do that. When we get done taking all these statues down, when we get done doing all this stuff, what's next? Like, how do we build ourselves up to be like the kings and queens that we envision.
Well, yeah. Okay, but that, back to what she was saying about like the South versus the North, I always say how it's so many levels to the Black race as a whole. Like comparing a Black kid that was raised in New York as opposed to one raised in New Orleans. You know what I mean?
Like, yeah, it's two different things.
Two totally different things. Like, faced with two totally different adversities. So, it's like, what's next? And we always say, like, we got to unite and we got to do this and we got to take action. But I'd be like, it's so many levels to the Black race that I just don't feel like it's one thing that
We all
can do, right? That's why, like, hopefully at home, if everybody, you know, like, sometimes I walk down the street, you know, like, when we feel so empowered as a race and we march or somebody did something good and we all happy, you know what I mean? And then I'll be walking down freaking Fulton Street and I just see a little Black boy being so bad and just look like a freaking baby kid cursing, being mad, ignorant, and ghetto. And I'll be like, look, just levels. I don't know. And this, I would say, and
basically, how, you're trying to say you don't relate to.
I don't see how
everybody is going to ever be on the same page.
Yeah, how we're all ever going
to
be in
With Carefree Black Girl, like, I would love to reach every type of audience there is out there, but everybody isn't going to get it. And Master P said it the best. If you can't understand it, it's not for you. Like, everything is not going to be for everybody, but you just have to try to be transparent enough for everybody to feel like they can have a space in your world as an artist, a personality, or whatever you want to be. I think that's important, you know what I mean? And that's why people love people like the R. Kellys and the people that we hate, because they've given lots of people something to relate to, you know what I mean? So, like, I don't know. It's kind of weird. I do get what you're saying. Like, every Black person is not going to stand together because we all don't believe in the same shit. Like, some people just don't care. We were talking about that earlier.
We all dealing with different shit. Like, people dealing with, they don't have food in their house and they're getting evicted. They not worried about marching and posting Instagram videos of, like, oh, like, Black people, what are we going to do next? Like, some of them, like, fuck that shit. Like, I'm about to go rob me a nigga. I don't got, you know, like.
Nah. I agree with you're saying, like, with what you're saying, that people are focused on, like, different things. Like, before they could be worried about what's going on in Virginia, they need to worry how they're going to get their next meal. But I'm just saying, like,
a lot of these things are in place because in of place. Society's social structure. Like, it's
so.
That is true.
So that's, it's very, like, very true.
Right, that's what I said. That's why I said it's levels, like the South versus the North.
It's not even. I mean, up here to me is. I mean, I don't know. I can't. I never lived in.
It's just like even different. Like on the West Coast, like everywhere you have different. Just like everywhere you have different levels of understanding. We might can relate because, even though I'm from the South and y'all from up here, like, we have a same. We have the common ground of being in New York and being exposed to New York. So, like, everybody is just different. I do think that the common thing is the way we're all treated in our society. And that should be the thing that brings us together, because it's a lot of things that are in place. Like she was saying, like, as far as food stamps and like who decides who gets food stamps, like, yo, in Georgia, you gotta be able, like, if you make over like $200 a week, you're not getting food stamps. But that's not really a lot of money when you're in college and stuff like that. Like, you kind of need that government. Like, if you're in college, unless you're doing work study, but you got to, like, stay in a certain range for work study.
Right.
You can't get no real money.
At all.
You don't get, like, food stamps. Because if you do, if you work another extra hour, they feel like that $7 can get you whatever food. So it's just, like, a lot of stuff that's
I remember, like, when I had, like, applied for food stamps. Like, this was back in, like, 2013. I was still in school. But, you know, I just, like, I'm paying for school. I'm giving my dad rent money. Like, I need to eat. They said that I made $50 more than the requirement.
Yeah.
And I'm struggling. Like, I'm like, now what, $50?
Yeah.
And it's just, it's mind-boggling. Like,
yeah, and it's like the cost of living, and you think of places like in New York, like a one-bedroom apartment is like,
what are we paying for up here besides the name?
1,400?
Somebody,
I love New York. They be, don't
rent be do like $2,700 and you're sharing a bathroom. Like that makes you have no parking space. You have no washer, no dryer, no central air. Like you're paying to be fucking hot, to be struggling. Like I really hate New York right now. Like look at our apartment. Deep, it's just deep. You got, and then it's like, all right, to get a good job to afford these apartments, you have to go to school. But it, so many things are against us. Like. Honestly.
Or being entertainment, but people don't believe entertainment until you make it.
That's true.
And then that's just like, it's just so many, how do we work it out? But
because I'm trying to tie it back to like self-esteem. Mm-hmm. And I feel like even like just when you're growing up and you're adulting in New York is extremely hard. Yeah. So when you feel like that has a play to me on your self-esteem, like if you feel like you're struggling and nothing's going right, you can start to really doubt yourself. Yeah. But if you like maintain that level of, I'm going to get through this. Like, you're literally gunning. Like, oh, it word. All,
that's important because I'm going so through that right
like,
now.
It's so important. Even with creative, is like, we out here struggling, but we create, like, the most beautiful
right.
things.
And that's
because
so
we
true.
Always see the bigger picture and we believe in us. So it really always, to me, goes back to, like, you knowing yourself and you knowing your self-worth. Like, the other day you was going through something that you thought you couldn't get through. Like, right. you are always. So if we keep that mindset that it's always going to be better. And then same as a black hole. If we always know, like, yo, we survived slavery. We survived Jim Crow.
Right.
We survived so much. Like, this is really, like, nothing.
That's how you make it through. And that's what I'm saying. Gotta, that's the next step.
Right.
Everybody, after this protest and everybody motherfuckers mad, after y'all take these monuments
it's like
down,
building our self-esteem
we got to build
as a black community.
Up. Yeah.
Like, that's, I think,
because even if a nigga was on the block acting crazy, if you walk past him, he should have been straightening up. And that should have been his, he should have been able to respect you as a woman for being out there.
Right.
Like, young boys got to know that from young. Like, yes. you know, like, it's not about how white people view you. You, it's like your people. Like, you want us to look better. You know
you
what I mean?
You want us, exactly.
You want us to
like,
have,
it be for us, like, we do things for us, but sometimes it's really not just for ourselves.
Right.
Like, that's why, like, I mean, even with this Carefree Black Girl movement and just, like, us just trying to, like, really make it because we want to show other black women, other black girls.
Yeah, it's so
tough. This is really bigger than us, really bigger than our brands. Like, this is just...
Every time I think about it, like, yo, what... It'd be so many times I'll just be like, oh, my God, I need to go to the studio. I need to not worry about that. I'd be thinking, like, that's not for just only for me.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's so many people that, like... follow this movement and that need that voice. And I think like knowing that I do help can help other people and that you guys help me. Like last week when we record, I was going through it and I text y'all. I was like, I know I can usually get food guys today. Ain't gonna be able to afford
right.
it. You know, the whole conversation, it was like therapy. And I feel like if I could come and feel that, right. I know other people, other places need
right.
that. So I feel like if more black people felt like it was just not about them,
right.
it would be. And I think that's what disgusts you. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
When you see it and you see people acting crazy on the street, it's like, don't you know that like it's other shit to be worried
right.
about? And you acting like this? Yeah,
and
I get.
Even
I definitely
last episode,
feel you.
It's just about not taking things personal.
Yeah.
Too. So.
Yeah.
Two for the night. All right. Stand on high, baby. Baby. There is only one for me. You have made that a possibility. We could take that step to see if this is really.
Okay, this was a good episode.
Yes, self-esteem. And you guys,
we talked about so many things and stemmed it back. Like,
self-esteem. Make sure y'all follow Bree on social media. It's Where She Begins and Plant Based Bree. Shout out to Bree. Check out her blog. Sorry she couldn't stay on air. Follow us on Twitter at CFBGPod. Email us if you want to be a guest. Email us if you have questions at carefreeblackgirlpodcast@gmail.com. And yeah,
people keep asking me like, do we interview people? Like, and we actually haven't yet. I was like, no, we just have guests.
I mean, y'all asked some questions when they came on.
Oh yeah,
it's not like it's
yeah,
kind of
girl
right. talk.
You're
so
right.
It's like, you know, it's not
really
a
that
spotlight
set up
on them,
right?
You know what I mean?
Exactly. Yeah, you're right. I didn't think about that. We haven't had a guest in a while, so
yeah,
that will be cool.
Well,
if anybody was interested,
yes,
you can follow me. This is Daj on Instagram. Everything NY, like New York.
I'm sorry. Social media is hilarious. You can follow me at Ivy Like Blue, no E at the end, on Twitter and Instagram. Also watch the latest episode of Iconic featuring my favorite rapper Drake.
Yes.
Super cool. So yeah.
That's it.
We out.
Until next time.
Next time, ladies. Open up your mind and just rest. I'm about to let you know you make me so.
What's up, everybody? It's your boy Tone, one half of the best black movie review podcast in the world. In the world, Craig. This episode of the Blackbusters podcast is brought to you by Amazon Prime. Prime is more than just free shipping. Prime brings you closer to the things you care about today through shopping, streaming, and savings. For example, did you know that you can listen to your favorite podcasts, like ours, through Amazon Music? Yup. You can also watch your favorite movies, like the ones we review on Blackbusters, on Amazon Prime Video. Yep. But it doesn't stop there. You can use Prime to get more out of your interests. From purchasing behind-the-scenes books about your favorite movies to listening to soundtracks of your favorite films. Yep, yep, and yep. Whatever you're into, or just getting into, Prime can help you get closer to it. Visit amazon.com/Prime to sign up. From movies and music to passions and podcasts, it's on Prime.